Welcome to Narc Abuse No More, where we're here to help educate you about narcissistic abuse because your feelings do matter. Hi, and welcome to another broadcast of Narc Abuse No More with your host, Dr. and Evangelist K.L. Rich. Thanks for tuning in today. Today is Wednesday, November the 12th of 2022. I pray that you've had a blessed, stress-free, narcissistic-free, abuse-free week so far, and that the remainder of this week will continue to be so as well. But if not, we're going to be talking about a few things today. Again, my name is Dr. K.L. Rich with Narc Abuse No More, where we're here to help you admit what you feel in order to heal from the effects of narcissistic abuse, because your feelings do what? They do matter. Yes, they do. But before we go on with today's broadcast, I would like to invite you to visit us on our website at www.narcabusenomore.org. Again, that website address is www.narcabusenomore.org. And on our website, you find valuable information regarding narcissism, regarding relationships. You can also listen to these broadcasts that have been on if you've missed any. Now, let me just let you know, we're now on every Monday, every Wednesday, every Friday. Okay, we were on Tuesdays and Fridays, but now we're on every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 a.m. Central on SoundCloud, Alha Radio, Spotify, Spreaker, Google Play, iTunes, Deezer, CastBox, and now Amazon Audible. Hello to all my Amazon fans. All right, what are we talking about today? 12 steps of recovery for narcissistic abuse victims. This is from the AA. The 12 steps of recovery for narcissistic abuse survivors. Yes, the 12 steps of recovery. And we're going to be going through the steps that they often go through for AA, but we're going to be talking about it for its narcissism, for its abuse, for its toxic relationships. And for those of you, you know, I'm an evangelist, I'm a Christian, and so I'm going to give you some scripture as well for those who may want to use this in a biblical spiritual, because it's all spiritual. When people are dealing with your emotions, when they're playing mind games, when they're abusing you, it affects you spiritually. Okay, regardless of what type of abuse it is. If it's physical abuse, it's affecting you spiritually. If it's emotional abuse, it's affecting you spiritually. If it's sexual abuse, it's abusing you spiritually. And so we're going to be talking about that as well. But we're going to be talking about 12 steps of recovery for narcissistic abuse victims. And you can find this on my website at www.narcabusenomore.org, or you can type in narcissisticabusenomore.com. Click on the narcissistic abuse tab and you will see sub tabs where you'll see the 12 steps of recovery for narcissistic abuse victims, or should I say survivors. We're talking about survivors. Okay, you're a survivor. If you have gone through abuse and you made it out with your mind, your sanity, you still in your right mind, you are a survivor. You might say, well, I'm still struggling with some things, some PTSD or something. You still are a survivor. So we're going to talk about 12 steps. And let me just say this. If you feel like I have not progressed, I have not gotten as far along on my road to recovery as I like, that's okay. Rome was not built in a day. Babies do not come out of the womb normally walking, okay? I've only seen one baby that the doctor was holding, and that baby was trying to take some steps. I'm like, whoa. But it's a step-by-step process, all right? It's a step-by-step process. And I've often used this analogy where when you know, when you're talking about babies, and you know, the baby's born, you got to hold their head because their neck muscles are not strong enough to hold their head yet, but eventually they're able to hold their head. You have to lay them on their back. We know about SIDS, but eventually they're going to start rolling over themselves. All right. They might not know how to crawl at first, but eventually they're going to start rocking. All right. They do that rock, and then they start moving them knees and crawling. You start teaching them those things. Eventually you're going to have to start watching them when you put them in that playpen, because guess what? When they get in that bed in that playpen, the first time that they crawl out of it, you might as well forget it. All right. But they're going to pull themselves up. You put them in the walker. The strength in their leg muscles, eventually they're going to start moving around in that walker, all right? At first, they're going to look around. They don't know what to do. And then eventually, they're going to be moving around that walker. And before you know it, they're going to be holding on to things. And before you know it, they're going to be walking into everything. It's a step-by-step process. And that's so, do not beat yourself up. Under no circumstances, if you feel like I'm not as further along on my road to recovery as I would like, that's okay. Take it one day at a time. One day at a time. So number one, we admit that we were powerless over narcissism, that our lives had become unmanageable. And let me just say this, because when you did not know anything about narcissism, when you didn't know anything about some things that you see, we know physical abuse is obvious. If somebody slap you, beat you, choke you, and all that kind of stuff, you know that's abuse. But sometimes people don't know abuse is... there's other types of abuse, other forms of abuse. You're talking about emotional abuse. You're talking about verbal abuse. You're talking about sexual abuse. You can kind of, you can know what that is, you know, rape and other things, molestation, all those things. And then some people even then may not have known, because they were in a family that there were a bunch of pedophiles in the family, and they molested, and they know it. They didn't know it wasn't normal for their fathers to be doing this type of thing to them. So we admit that we were powerless over narcissism. Many people did not know. They thought, you might have thought that you were crazy. You might have thought that something was wrong with you. You might not have known what to give it, what name to give it. You probably couldn't even identify what it was that was going on, but you knew something was wrong. So your life was unmanageable, and you trying to figure out, what is wrong? Is it me? Is it them? What is going on? You finally know, I've been dealing with some toxic individuals. Oh, I've been dealing with some narcissists. Oh, I've been dealing with some abusers. So now you have a name. So you may have admit right now that, hey, we admit that we were powerless over it at the time. That's temporary, though. That's temporary. Because when you know, then you know how not to play the narcissist game, the abuser's game, that toxic individual's game. In Romans chapter 5, verse 6, it says, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. We were powerless at one point, but no longer. When you know what you're dealing with, this is why it's so important to educate yourself, because the more education that you get about dealing with these type of individuals that like to master manipulate and control and devalue you and lower your self-esteem and your sense of value and don't value you, then you'll know how not to play the game. Number two, we know and believe that a power greater than ourselves can restore us to sanity. Yes, that power is God. We know that we can't do it on our own. We have to have some divine intervention. Let me let you know, because some of you have been listening to this broadcast for some years now, and it was God that led you here so that you can educate, you can become educated into what you were dealing with, to have confirmation of what you were dealing with, because you didn't have a name to put on it. You didn't have a title to put on it, but you knew something was wrong. And so therefore now you understand. Now you have that sense of sanity. Philippians 4 verse 13, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. That means that we know and believe that a power greater than ourselves can restore us to sanity. All right. Sanity doesn't mean that you in straitjacket. Sanity, you might be in a straitjacket in your mind, but you sanity, losing your sanity doesn't mean you're in a straitjacket. Everybody that's cuckoo for cocoa is not behind four walls. We're not making fun of those who are mentally ill or anything like that. What we're saying is people that can do better should know better, and those that know better should operate better. Okay, so what I'm saying right now is we know that a power greater than ourselves can restore us to sanity. You might say, well, I don't have the strength. I can't, some people struggle with this when it comes to splitting ways with an abuser or abusers or people that are toxic. But I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. That means that we need a higher power greater than ourselves to restore us to sanity. Some of us, God allowed us to get educated. We may have gone to school. We may have learned from others. We may have done some research. We may have read some books. We may have talked to some counselors. But I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength, because he gives me that power. That means that even if it means sitting with a counselor, I have that power because of God. Number three, we have made the decision to turn our will and our lives totally over to the care of God, for he knows us better than we know ourselves. Whatever it is you're struggling with, because let me just say that some people are struggling with addictions due to being abused. You're dealing with maybe alcohol. You're dealing with maybe drugs. You're dealing with maybe food. You're dealing with low self-esteem. You're dealing with being a people pleaser. You're dealing with some form of sabotage and self-sabotage. But when you make that decision to turn your life totally to the care of God, then you don't have to be alone. You're not alone. In Psalms 55 verse 22, it says, cast your burden on the Lord and he will sustain you. He will never permit the righteous to be moved. Sometimes you have to lay that burden on God. All the time. Let me just say all the time. Not sometimes, all the time. But lay it on God, because when you carrying it around, then you carrying all these bags. We talked about the weight of weights. And speaking of which, I'm still in the process of editing the final book, but it will be out I believe by next week. You carry these weights. And you got to turn those weights over. Many people are carrying weights and you wonder, why is this new relationship not working? Why isn't the last one? And you bring in old bags into new relationships. The Bible talks about old wine skins. You can't put new wine into old wine skins, because it wouldn't do it right. It would explode. Okay? So you got to turn it over. Turn your will over. Say that I can't do this by myself. Number four, we have made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves, not according to the abuser's standard, but in alignment with God's. That means that I'm evaluating myself. See, the abuser wants you to see yourself through their eyes. No, we see ourselves through the eyes of God. You evaluate yourself. What is it that I need to do to be a better person? What is it, some things that I might need to eliminate to be a better person? What is it that some people I might need to disconnect from to be a better person? Who is it that's toxic in my life where I might need to maybe put some distance in between, because I need to be a better person? In Galatians chapter 6 verse 4, each one should test their own actions. Then they can take pride in themselves along without comparing themselves to someone else. Never compare yourself to someone else. Never look at yourself through someone else's eyes. See, when you're dealing with toxic individuals, when you're dealing with abusers, when you're dealing with narcissists, they want you to see yourself through their eyes. They don't want you to feel good about yourself. They don't want you to value yourself. They don't want you to think highly of yourself. And I'm not talking about in a prideful sense. I'm talking about have that sense of self-worth. worth. That's why the Bible says that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That means that I'm not going to feel bad about myself because God has given me the strength. So therefore, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. But when you're dealing with toxic people, they don't want you to. They don't want to see that side of you. They don't want you to think that of yourself. So therefore, they do everything to destroy. They think they want to have control over your sense of worth. They want to be the one to put the price tag on you. And as long as you let them do that, you will never see the full sense of who you are as an individual. Number five, and then we're going to take a quick break. We have admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being, the exact nature of the wrongs done against us as part of our healing process. This was done not to take revenge, but was necessary, even if it meant reporting a crime done against us to local law enforcement for justice to be served when deemed appropriate. You do not have to feel guilty because you said and you called out what was done wrong to you. What type of abuse was done against you? Many times people feel as if you gotta sweep it up under the rug. You should never say anything. You're a good person as long as you don't expose at the point of it hurting you. Abusers thrive off of silence because they get a chance to do it to the next person, the next person, the next person. Some people have abusers in their family and you hush, hush, hush. You don't say it. You don't tell nobody. You don't expose it. You don't let anybody know. And if you do let somebody know, then shame on you. This is what they want. And there's nothing wrong. See, the abuser will make you feel like you're wrong for exposing it. You're not wrong for exposing it. It's not slander. It is nothing wrong with saying this was done to me. Because they're going to make sure that they don't look bad. And sometimes the exposure will put them in their place, will check them. And if it means, if you've been, for those who may have been sexually assaulted or whatever, and you say, okay, I need to report it, or maybe I shouldn't report it as a family member or something like that. If you're a teenager and someone is molesting you in your family, you need to tell. You need to report. And if your family don't believe you, tell it to the law. How many teenagers, children, are being abused by those in their own household? Sexual abuse, physical abuse, verbal, emotional abuse. Just the, it was a few days ago, it might have been last week, I read about this mother, and she had given her child, her daughter, to a man for sex. She wanted money. He gave her, I believe, $25 for her 5-year-old girl, and the girl wound up dying. She traded $25, prostituted her daughter, 5 years old. That's abuse. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be back. Before we go there though, let me just read this in Romans chapter 12 verses 17 through 21. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends. Do not leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed them. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This means that, we see, the thing is that, don't get this confused. You're not taking revenge just because you report something that is being done to you, some harm that's being done. This is saying here is that don't repay evil with evil. Not this has nothing to do with reporting something that was done wrong. But remember that God is the one that gets the vengeance. The Bible says vengeance is the Lord's, and let him be the one to take vengeance. We're to pray for our enemies. It doesn't mean that you let them keep mistreating you, but we're still to pray for our enemies. The Bible tells us to feed them, give them something to drink, whatever. But the thing is that you don't let them take advantage of you. Someone who has molested you, abused you sexually, physically, verbally, emotionally, you don't have to be anybody's doormat. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be back in just a moment. Well, there's a bridge and there's a river that I still must cross as I'm going on my journey. Though I might be lost, and there's a well, no one told me just how to get there. But when I get there, I know, 'cause I'm taking it. What we're doing right now, we're talking about step by step. Number six, we are entirely ready to have God remove the narcissist list concerning our defects of character from our minds and allow only the things of God to infiltrate our mind, body, and spirit. So many people are walking around with the movie marathon of what the abuser said to you, what they said over you, what they spoke about you, what they spoke to you. And it's time to erase it. It's time to allow God to take it away. You're walking around with this list. You're thinking, oh, I'm what this narcissist have said. I will never do this. I will never do that. I'm not this. I'm not that. I don't deserve this. I don't deserve that. And you're carrying all these bags of what someone said and spoke over you. It's time to let God take it away from you. In Philippians 2 verse 5, it says, you must have the same attitude that Christ had. What does that mean? That means that because Jesus thought that I was worthy enough to come die for, that means that I don't have to listen to anyone who tells me I'm not good enough. I'm not smart enough. I'm not worthy. You don't have to listen to those things. Allow him to take that from you. Number seven, we have humbly asked God to remove our shortcomings, self-doubt, and low opinion of ourselves by teaching us first how to love him and then ourselves. Many people don't know how to love themselves. I'm not talking about the way the narcissist is. It's all about me, 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 and me. I'm talking about loving yourself as Christ loves you. Many people have low opinion of themselves. They look at themselves as, I'm not talented enough. I'm not beautiful enough. I'm not good enough. I don't have this. I don't have that. I'm never going to amount to this. Self-doubt, shortcomings, low opinions of yourself. In Ephesians chapter 5, verses 28 through 29, it says, in the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. Indeed, no one has ever hated his own body, but he nourishes and cherishes it just as Christ does the church. What does this mean? This means God loves us. That's why in the Bible it tells husbands to love your wives as Christ loves the church. Because no one hates his own body. And this is saying that we're to have a positive mindset of ourselves. Not hating your own body means don't hate yourself. Let me just say this. We all have something that we want to work on. Me right now, I'm doing a bunch of smoothies and stuff. I'm trying to lose some more pounds, okay? I'm trying to lose some more weight. But guess what? I still have to love myself regardless of my imperfections. You see, we tend to look at the negatives, but you need to look at the positives. What is it that I have good that's going on in my life? You know, last year for me, I earned my doctorate degree. Well, I'm Dr. Rich now. I wouldn't say I'm top of the line seamstress, but I sew good. I cook good. I there's a lot of things. I'm very creative. I write. I teach. I do a lot of things. What is it about you that can raise that low opinion of yourself? Something that you're good at. Look in the mirror. What is something about you that you like? Maybe you have thick hair. Somebody doesn't have thick hair, they have alopecia. You know, I know I struggle with my edges. That's something I wish I can change, but hey, it is what it is. You might like the way your nose look. What is it about you? This is not being self-absorbed. This is saying, you know what? I gotta learn to love myself because I'm carrying the weight of doubt. I'm carrying the weight of low self-esteem. I'm carrying the weight, for some people, of self-sabotage, because when I'm almost about to make it in life, I do something to self-sabotage. What is it that you're carrying? Number eight, We have made a list of all the people who have harmed us and turned our enemy list into a prayer list. Oh, you might say, I'm not praying for that abuse. I'm not praying for them. Let me just say this. Those of us as Christians, we know that we have to. Those of you who say you may not, you need to learn to pray for that person. Let me, and what it does is it helps to get rid of the anger, the bitterness, the resentment. Does this mean, see, this is also a part of forgiving, because when we say, hey, I want to heal, part of that healing means forgiveness. It does not, forgiveness is not saying that, oh, it's okay what they did. No. But what it's saying is that, you know what? I got to move on. I got to let it go. Because if I don't let it go, it's going to ruin me. It's going to cripple me. It's going to keep me from growing. It'll be like you planting the seed and you waiting for it to sprout, but then you put a bunch of bricks on top of it to keep it from coming up. And that's what people are doing. You're not able to grow because you're carrying all these bricks. You have to let it go. So that means that even if it means making a prayer list of all the people who harmed you, pray. Not a revenge list, a prayer list. Matthew 5:43-44. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Number 9, we accept that the narcissist may never change and cannot change independent of God, but know that the change will begin in us. You might be saying right now, well, no, they're not going to change. And some people are holding on to, oh, well, they'll change. When you're dealing with someone who has not accepted or acknowledged that they have done wrong, because narcissists normally don't. They don't acknowledge that they've done anything wrong, or they, even if they admit it out of their mouth, it's not in their heart. So if you have to accept that they may never change, and they will not change independent of God, but therefore you can change. You can change how you respond, respond instead of react. Learn to respond, not react. Reaction, it goes off at any given moment. You're going to tell them a piece of your mind, and then you get to arguing and you never go anywhere. But responding means I choose my battles. In Romans 12:1-2, it reads, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, that is good and acceptable and perfect. That means you have to transform your mind, transform your thinking. Don't think that they're going to change. You have to be the change. You have to be the one to change. Sometimes that's going to mean setting boundaries. Sometimes that's going to mean low contact. Some toxic individuals are going to be no contact. But you have to be that change. Number 10, we will continue to take personal inventory. And when we are wrong, but we will promptly admit it, so that we will not take on the characteristics of the narcissist. When they try to devalue, gaslight, triangulate, or manipulate us, we will totally disregard their attempts, even if it means a modification of contact, and turn them over to God. Do not expect an abuser to be anything but an abuser, but you can pray for them. When they try to devalue you, gaslight you, triangulate you, or manipulate you, disregard it. Do not feed into it. You know their tools. You can't expect them to change it. However, take inventory of when we do wrong. The thing is, you don't want to be like the narcissist when you know you're wrong and then you never say, I'm wrong, I'm sorry, and truly mean it. Be the opposite of what the narcissist is. And when attempts at reconciliation, because we'd all be ministers of reconciliation, but when the attempts of reconciliation is impossible, then you have to be that change and modify. Sometimes you have to modify being around that individual. In Psalms 34, verses 17 through 20, it says, when the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of all of them. He keeps all his bones. Not one of them is broken. And we know that Jesus' bones was not broken. Not one was broken. And we know that the Lord was near the brokenhearted. And sometimes we often have broken bones, not in the literal sense, but we have broken spirits. We were crushed at heart because of the things that has taken place maybe in life. But the thing is, when we cry out to God, God hears and he delivers us out of our troubles. And some of you, that deliverance has been going to someone to get help. God has placed someone in your path. A support group, a counselor, a therapist, a friend, a family member. He has put someone in your path to be that place of hope. And you don't have to deal with it alone. Because God hears, he heals, he delivers, and he understands. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be back in just a moment.
We all want to make a place in this world. We all want our voices to be heard. Everyone wants a chance to be some.
Whitney Houston is an artist of unparalleled stature. Her celestial voice can sing a song like it was sent special delivery from heaven.
I thank you all for believing in me, and I'd like to thank those who didn't, too.
Thank you.
You were loved, and that is by Whitney Houston. All right, so we're winding down. Number 11. We will continue to seek God through prayer and fasting to improve our relationship with Him and for guidance in dealing with others. We will ask for knowledge concerning His will for our lives and the power and wisdom to carry it out. It's impossible to be able to have the strength that you need without God. Some people might say, I don't believe in God. Well, I'm here to tell you today, He is real. And you will be able to be that best person that you can be by placing your trust in Him to help you improve your relationships with others. First with Him, then with others. And then improving who you think of. First, think about yourself. When we don't understand the purpose that God has for our lives, it's almost impossible to even have good relationships because we're without purpose. And so therefore you go from one relationship to the next, not understanding, and one abusive relationship to the next, one toxic relationship from the next, in search of really finding yourself. And we can find ourselves through God. Because why? Because He created us. Well, who best know how to operate the car than the Creator? I'm talking about you. If you get a Toyota, then guess who know about it? Toyota. You get a Ford, guess who knew about it? Ford. You know, BMW, the BMW makers. It's the same way with us. Who can best reset us, restart us, send us back to factory restart before all that stuff happens? The abuse is the person who created you. Number 12. As a result of following these steps, we will be able to carry this message to other narcissistic abuse survivors and show them how to practice these principles in their daily lives. Let me go back. I forgot to read the verse. And in Psalms 119, when we talked about we will continue to seek God through prayer and fasting, Psalms 119, 105, Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. That means that when we need direction, ask God. When we don't know what to do, ask God. When we need to have understanding regarding relationships that we may enter, ask God. His word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto my path. Because sometimes we need some light. We don't see too well. We may have the trifocuses on, but we don't see too well. Ask God. As a result of following these steps, we will be able to carry this message to other narcissistic abuse survivors to show them how to practice these principles in their daily lives. That means that I'm not only helping myself, but I'm helping future victims. I'm helping future survivors. I tell them where things may have turned for me, where things may have gone wrong for me, and I help them along the way. Because after all, we are here to help each other. In the Bible, the story of Cain and Abel, Cain asked God, am I my brother's keeper? Of course, yes, you are. We are each other's keeper. He was saying it sarcastically to God when God asked him about his brother Abel, whom he had killed out of jealousy and rage. But yes, we are each other's keeper. And if you know someone that has traveled that same road or is on the road that you're on, be a support to one another. Help the other person to get to where you are or where you're trying to go. And you can be a strength to each other. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15, it says, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Always be prepared to give a person for that reason of your hope? What has helped you along the way? Who have helped you along the way? What has helped you along the way? And for many of us, it's God. He's the only one. He's the only one that can help, restore, deliver, and set free. Put you back to factory settings before all those things. You know how sometimes you have to reboot your phone. Sometimes you have to send it back to factory settings. Sometimes your computer needs a factory restart to go back to the date before it started acting up. Yeah, many of us have had to have a factory restart. And that's okay, because that's good. That means that we can go back. In a literal sense, no, we can't go back in a literal sense, but God can make it where you go back to factory restart and make it as if you've never been touched through any type of abuse, physical, verbal, emotional, spiritual, financial. We have to place our complete trust in Him. All right, I pray that today's broadcast has been a blessing to you. And again, we're on every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 a.m. Central. And if you're unable to listen at that time, guess what? You can always catch us in the archives. We are here for you because your feelings do matter. This is Dr. K.L. Rich with Narc Abuse No More. Remember, you're on that road to recovery. Step by step. Until next time.